All right. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to Caffè, Lena. Thank you for being here tonight. It is the second night of Jordan Rudess's visit here to Caffè, Lena, and we have been operating. This is now our 62nd year, and I will say that these shows are very unique for Caffè, Lena, and it is a really special opportunity for us here as a venue to host Jordan and for everybody in the audience tonight to see this show. We are also live streaming this show, so thank you to everybody who is tuning in wherever you are watching tonight. We're grateful to have you here with us sharing this experience. And so I introduced Jordan last night, and one of the things that I said about him, in addition to the fact that he is, you know, the keyboardist for Dream Theater, and known for that sort of progressive style of music, I talked about pushing boundaries in music, and I will admit that I was wrong, because it, you know, seeing this show here in such a small, intimate setting, I realized that really what it is just total freedom. And it was such a cool experience to see that unfold with someone who understood that freedom for themselves at their instrument. So I hope you enjoy that experience with us tonight. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming him back up on stage at Caffè, Lena. This is Jordan Rudess.
Hey, everybody, what do you think of my tape up here? I have it just in case I want to tape a key down. No, actually, I have it here. I don't know what to say. Okay. Put that over there. Good evening, everyone. So great to be here. What fun to be able to play for all of you. Thanks for coming out. So let's see. Probably for some of you, it's your second night out since things have started to open up again, because maybe you came last night. Because I asked last night, how many of you, is this your first show since we kind of started to open up things? I guess I'll ask the same thing. How many of you, like, this is your first show? I definitely see some hands. Yeah. It's one of my first shows, but I've been doing some piano solo shows. And also, as I mentioned last night, I think that I played the very last big rock show right before the whole world closed down. It was with Deep Purple on March 13th in Mexico City. It was for like 60,000 people. It was crazy. I remember arriving in Mexico going, how many people have COVID here? And at that time they were like, well, I think we have five, the promoter reps, I think we have five people that have COVID. Of course, 2 days later, the entire world closed down and it was a complete mess and I got home just in the nick of time. But then on the other side of that, I managed to do the Deep Purple show, and then I also, I think I was one of the first ones to start playing again, just as, you know, as things would have it, which is really cool. So I get to, you know, get things in motion again. And one of these days, not too far from now, I think Dream Theater will hit the road as well. So we'll have some fun doing that. Thanks. So let's see. So I opened up the show. I always have a piece of music in front of me just in case I want to play it, but I didn't want to because I felt like, you know, I should just vibe with you guys and make something up. So that whole first piece was totally off the top of my head. And maybe it was even recorded because I know we're streaming. So, the only thing that was the same as the first piece, I think the first chord of the piece I might have played was in G. So I think I hit a G chord, or maybe I didn't. I don't even know, but I definitely didn't use that. So what I want to tell you about is a couple of things. Number one is I was talking to Danielle, my wife, and she was saying, you know what, you should tell people what you do, because it's kind of unusual, and I like to share with you a little bit about what I do and what I'm gonna do. So during the course of this event, I'm gonna play some, you know, tunes that you guys know, and I'm also gonna play some maybe tunes that you don't know. But a lot of things that I play are based on melodies, and every time I play something, it's not necessarily the same. I tend to play from my heart and my mind, and I kind of know the chords and the scales, and I just let myself, it's like talking for me. That's why I could improvise like that in the first song, and that's like why when you hear me play a song, generally it's not going to be the same way twice, because, hey, I don't even remember the way I played something the last time, so there's no point. I'll just play it a different way, and I love to do that. So on that note, the next song I'm going to play is a song from an album that I did during the lockdown, which is called A Chapter in Time. And that album was very much like a musical diary. It was really personal. I would go into my studio like every day when we were locked down, and I would just make music. And I was recording the music without necessarily the plan to release anything. I was just letting my emotions out in the way that I do. And after a while, I had a whole bunch of music that I had recorded, and I kind of thought about it, and I went back and said, I should go through this and maybe release this, because it would be kind of cool. So, of course, then, you know, just to choose all the pieces was one thing, but then to name everything was another. And luckily, about a year ago, I started a Patreon. And one of the things that the patrons love to do is they like to engage. And I found that one of the great ways to engage everybody is to ask them to help name the songs. So I got some great names, including this next one, Twilight Rain. Definitely saved me a lot of time and energy, because it's hard to name instrumentals, you know? So they definitely did that. So this is a piece off of A Chapter in Time. And again, the melody is, you know, something that will remain somewhat intact, but the arrangement is always a little bit different. So here we go. Thank you. So when I was a young person starting the piano, my first teacher was this guy, I remember his name, a long time ago, Mr. Litow. He was a pretty cool guy, would come around, you know, he's the kind of teacher who would do the half an hour lesson and then kind of be on his way. When he met me, he realized I had a pretty good ear right away, and he decided to throw away the book I was learning from. It was the little red book that people learn from, you know, the one. And so he tossed it, and he wrote down all the chords. I think he wrote down like the circle of fifths or something like that. And I kind of had my way with that, and I was playing, and he was really happy, and he would come joyfully. I think he gave me some extra lessons on the side as well. And but one day, a friend of my mother's came in and heard me play and heard about what was going on. And she said, you know what, Jordan should really have more serious lessons. And she had a neighbor whose name was Magda. Now, Magda was this Hungarian woman, very passionate, a piano teacher. And the plan was for me to go to Magda to study. Magda's story was that she had a son who was going to the Juilliard College. And he left there to join Guy Lombardo's band. So Magda was very, very upset about that. And when she met me at the age of 8, she said, you're going to be the one who's going to go to Juilliard. I'm going to get you ready to go to Juilliard, and you're going to have a classical piano career. Magda's not alive anymore, which might be, in a way, a good thing, because if she saw me now, she would be, you know, pretty upset since I decided not to do that. So when I started at Juilliard, my teacher, whose name was Catherine Parker, she was amazing. And I remember the first lesson with her, I was playing this. But I was doing like... And she was like, no, you cannot do that. That's absolutely not okay. You can't improvise here. You have to play by the book. So I would take my... down the hall and all the blues... And I'd bring some of the other students in, and I'd let them check out crazy, crazy styles. And it was kind of like the secret thing. And then I'd come back into the hallway, and I'd get very straight-laced and do my classical thing. But I stayed with it for a long time until, of course, you know, things changed. We'll talk more about that as we go. But my teacher really wanted me to play Bach and play it without improvising. And to honor her, in my kind of full circle here, I am playing some Bach, and I'm going to try not to improvise. So this is Partita number 5 in G major. Thank you. I didn't improvise. That's the way the piece goes. I usually would improvise if I like screwed it up, but I never stopped. That was one thing that was really good. You know, my teacher never admitted it, but when I was a kid, you know, and I'd space out, I'd mess up, and I would improvise. She'd always be like, oh my God, oh my God. But the reality is where most people would stop, I didn't stop. I kept on going, playing whatever came into my head. So there always was an advantage to that. All right, so, you know, during this break, I happen to be very musically active, in addition to kind of being locked down like everybody else and just kind of hanging out at my piano and everything. Also, we did manage to create some other music. One of the great projects that I did in the break was after 22 years. We did Liquid Tension Experiment. We all managed to get together. Thanks. Yeah, that was pretty fun. And then after Liquid Tension got together, we figured, well, we're on a roll here. So we managed to get Dream Theater back in the studio. And we finished making a new album, which you'll hear sometime in the fall. I don't think there's a release date. Matter of fact, I know there's not a release date yet, but I think you're really going to enjoy it. It's very cool. So speaking of Liquid Tension, going back a little bit, the next piece I'm going to play is one of my favorites from our past catalog, although I will play some of the new stuff for you as well. This is a song called By Accident, and it's one of my favorites. It's a band song, but of course I arranged it for piano, so I hope you dig it. So, as I was saying before about my love of progressive rock music, so, you know, started out improvising, switched to all classical but secret improvising, and then finally, you know, my friends were turning me on at the age of like 17 and 18 as I was kind of getting to that transition point between the pre-college of Juilliard, which I had been going to since 9, and deciding whether to go to the college level of Juilliard. So to make a long story short, all those albums they were turning me on to, I loved so much. The one that really changed my life completely was the Tarkus album by Emerson, Lake, and Palmer. That really did it. As far as being a keyboard player and saying, oh my God, look what you can do on a keyboard. That was pivotal. But musically speaking, there was a lot of other things that spiritually kind of changed my direction. Things like King Crimson, Genesis, and Yes, and all those groups that mean so much to me. And I'm going to play a little bit of that kind of music tonight, I guess, obviously. But I'm going to play a song called Moonchild right now. It's a King Crimson song that I really, really like.
Thank you.
Thanks so much. So as I was saying, we got in the studio with LTE3. Dream Theater recently has been lucky enough to kind of start our own headquarters. And it's been really cool because we don't have any like studio limitations or anything like that. We can go in, we can record, we can take our time, we can mess up and not feel like we have to rush through. We don't mess up. But we can do what we want and really just take our time. So when we were in the studio with LTE3, you know, it's a lot of pressure to go into the studio with like an LTE project. And the reason it's a lot of pressure, well, a couple of reasons this time around. One is because after 22 years and having it be the most requested album in the course of my musical career, that felt a little like pressure. Like, I think it has to be good after 22 years, you know? The other pressure that I honestly felt was that we're going in the studio for a couple of weeks and going to make this like miracle happen. Like, what happens if the muse is not like playing along, is not with me? You know, that would be a problem, because I definitely had some kind of like thoughts about what I wanted the album to be like. And, you know, so I was thinking about that. And a couple of weeks before we went into the studio, my family went on a trip to Rhode Island, and I brought a little IK multimedia portable keyboard that I could plug into my iPad, and I thought, you know what, I'll try to get some ideas just in case, you know? So I actually did come up with some ideas, and I came up with this one melody that I had sent to John, and I sent to Mike. I said, oh, guys, I like this melody. What do you think? And they're like, yeah, it's beautiful. So that melody is actually the main chorus of Shades of Hope, which is the duet that John and I did on this last album. And I asked him to come out tonight, but he was kind of busy, so he's not here. But I'm going to do a solo piano arrangement of this song, which is called Shades of Hope. Thank you. Yes, I like that song too. I don't know, that King Crimson album just was so amazing. I think, you know, King Crimson has had so many different albums and so many periods, and it's all so awesome. But that one, I don't know, I think it's something like, you know, I try to think of like, what makes like a favorite album like that? Like I ask people, like, what's your favorite Dream Theater album? Something, oh, like Scenes from Memory, Images and Words, this or that. And I think maybe it has to do with like when you initially got that hit, you know, when you really just heard it and you went, oh my God, I love this. And then that's like the biggest thing. Maybe that's, it's a theory. Anyway, so, thank you. So, so back to LTE3. So yeah, this next song is also off the new LTE3 album. This was, I look back and I think about the thinking behind wanting to do this, like on the piano. And I think it probably is just related to the fact that I'm like a prog musician. Like prog musicians like to torture ourselves, you know, to do crazy hard stuff. It's the only thing in my life that I like to do that's like really hard. Everything else maybe take the easy route, but with music I always like try to go into the hardest thing and figure it out. So that's probably what happened here. So this song is the epic off the LTE3 album. It's called Key to the Imagination, band song obviously, and gonna attempt it on the keyboard. What do you guys think of this Korg instrument? It's cool, right? Yeah, it's awesome. It's not a Kronos, which is the instrument that I take on stage with Dream Theater. It's called a Grand Stage, but it has a lot of the sounds of a Kronos. It's more like you don't think about all the editing and stuff like that. It's more like you can just have a couple of great sounds and balance between them. Anyway, very cool. Here's Key to the Imagination. Thank you. I guess I could be excused for not going to the gym today. It's a bit of like a workout. So, so we can all kind of recover from that one. I think I'm going to switch gears a little bit and get a little bit mellow. Otherwise, my hands are going to fall off. It's about pacing, ladies and gentlemen. You know, when I play in Dream Theater or Liquid Tension, I'll go crazy for a while and do something really ridiculous, and then John Petrucci goes nuts for a while, and I can go have a drink or something. Well, not really, but I can, you know, take it easy. But not when it's a solo concert. Then it's all on you. Then all the energy has to come from me, which is fine. I dig that. It's a great way to practice focusing. So, yes, so let's get back to a little bit of Chapter in Time. This is one of my personal favorites from that album. It's a song called Weightless. Not Waitlist, Weightless. Okay, just making sure everybody's got that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Well, if you don't know what that last piece was, I'm not surprised. So I just made it up. Okay. I was going to play something else, but then I looked at it and went, nah, not tonight. I'll play this. I'll just make something up. So I used the sound I had planned, but that was about it. So this next piece is a piano piece that I wrote. It's called Interstices. It was named by my longtime engineer, John Guth. I never remember what it means. Does anybody know what it means? Nobody knows. It's something to look. You have your homework from the show. Go home and look at what interstices means. It actually has a meaning, and it does relate to the song because my friend John, the engineer, is very smart, and he gave it a good name. I like the sound of it. I never remember what it means. But anyway, I do remember how to play it. So that's a good thing. So here we go. Interstices, take one. Thank you. Thanks so much, everybody. After the show's over, I will go back to that area over there and say hello to you guys by the merch thing and sign some stuff if you like. So I'll see you there. Cool. Thank you.